When we consider the strategic challenge of China, the characterization does speak to a deeper truth. China is playing four-dimensional chess across every element of national security, militarily, economically, diplomatically, and culturally. In the maritime domain and in the South China Sea in particular, China's aggressive island-building campaign and its rejection of international law threaten not just regional stability, but long-standing U.S. interests in the free flow of commerce, freedom of navigation, and diplomatically resolving disputes consistent with international law. Economically, I sincerely hope that the current U.S.-China trade negotiations will result in real structural reform. Over the past decade, we've seen a determined China bend the rules to its own benefit on trade and economic matters as it's made its way to be the world's second largest economy. But structural challenges remain in China's often cyber-enabled theft of intellectual property rights, in its unfair advantages by manipulating market access, and in its underwriting of state-owned enterprises, and the intertwined relationships between companies like Huawei and the Chinese national security apparatus raise serious questions. Diplomatically, China has fashioned a brand of international diplomacy often rooted in manipulative investment. More subtly, China's Belt and Road Initiative has seen its influence work its way across the world in port contracts and United Nations voting patterns. Overtly, China continues cooperation with North Korea, where after some initial toughening in 2017 and 18, we once again see a lessening of pressure out of concern for regime stability. China has developed complex influence campaigns by traditional and non-traditional means. China may not manipulate social media the way we saw with Russian tradecraft in 2016, but its tentacles of influence are far-reaching. The launch of the Confucius Institutes on many U.S. campuses, the desire to set up party cells in U.S. businesses, and espionage targeted at both universities pursuing high-tech research all speak to the pervasive extent of China's united front efforts. And while we consider Chinese foreign policy endeavors, let us also point out that domestically, Xi Jinping has overseen the emergence of a neo-Maoist authoritarian model and a total surveillance state. The government is pursuing a brutal crackdown on the Uyghurs in Xinjiang, including the internment of an estimated 1 million people in camps subjected to, quote, re-education campaigns, forced labor, and total surveillance. All of these dynamics make constructing an effective China policy uniquely challenging for U.S. policymakers. Now, I know it may surprise some of my colleagues, but I agree with President Trump when it comes to recognizing the scope of challenge that China presents to the United States and to the entire international order. But I do not think the president has found the right approach. As others have noted, merely being more confrontational with China does not make us more competitive with China. So we have to ask, are there still opportunities for cooperation? What are the risks of the competition becoming conflict? 30 years ago, we debated whether or not China would rise to be a major power. 10 years ago, we wondered what sort of power China would be. Today, the book is not by any means closed. On the contrary, new pages and chapters are beginning to emerge. And I have to tell you, Mr. Chairman, the reading so far is not promising. We must be holistically strategic, leveraging all of our diplomatic tools. Slashing America's foreign affairs budget, as the Trump administration has yet again proposed, weakens our ability to effectively confront China's economic and diplomatic reach around the globe. As we contemplate a more competitive environment with China, we also need to pay attention to building, not destroying, our alliances and partnerships. I have repeatedly argued that core American values must be the centerpiece of our foreign policy. China's model is appealing, unfortunately, in all too many parts of the world. We must offer a better model. In celebrating the 40th anniversary of the Taiwan Relations Act and a strong partnership with Taiwan, we also celebrate the values of a flourishing democracy. So I look forward to hearing from our witnesses today on how to better understand the strategic and economic realities unfolding with the rise of China and how to best structure U.S. policy to safeguard our national interests and our values.